Christian way is to surrender your life to Jesus, meaning that your the circumstances of your life, the seemingly greater will than you that is telling you what to do and where to, you know, how to live your life, you put Jesus in charge instead of this other dictator, you know. And then Jesus says, okay, the Holy Spirit is going to carry out my wishes for your life and will be with you at all times, something like that. And that's an entirely legitimate way to do it. And so we are simply what I call in the great universal tradition of truth and clarity. We are doing basically the same thing. We're just saying, Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit, you be in charge as this greater will that can tell me what to do. Can tell me what to do. That tells me what to do, that arranges my life, that gets me, you know, food and shelter and money and a place, and tells me where to go, who to see, everything. You be in charge. And the hard thing to realize is that all the suffering that we've gone through, it's really, we designed it for ourselves by telling this projected will, you know, projected will, I want to do this, but you got to make sure I can't do that and thwart me, you know, so I can feel as if you're more powerful than I am. And so we go through life undermining ourselves. You know, I know this is something that psychologists have realized, that people are very odd, actually. It's like psychologists have recognized this, therapists, that people are stranger than they can account for, really. But they don't really understand why they're doing all this stuff. You know, why do we sabotage ourselves? Why do we undermine ourselves? Why do we go out of the frying pan into the fire? Why do we want something so much and then we're not able to get it? And then we're so upset. Because we're trying to empower this will, this other will, so that we can feel there's something stronger than us, so we can feel there's something stronger than God, so our ambition to be greater than God can be fulfilled. But even more than that is so that the continuity issue doesn't rise up and bite us. We say, let's just keep the status quo, no matter what. Let's just keep the status quo. That's really where we're at now. I think most of us are past the stupid whim of trying to be greater than God. Now we're just like holding on for dear life, saying, oh my gosh, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? I made this Frankenstein monster of projection, perception, personality, and I can't, and now I'm too afraid to drop it, so I just got to hang on to it at all costs. Hang on. The way I look at people is that most people are simply just hanging on for dear life. You know, just, wow, I hope this whole thing doesn't collapse, they're saying. And they just praying. You know, and I know a lot of people, they go through life, and in their life, they say, oh, man, I made it through without collapsing, with this all this complex collapsing. They say, that's good enough, that's good enough. So in other words, the worst thing that could have happened to me, they're thinking, didn't happen. So that's how they define their life, that the worst thing that could have happened didn't happen. So they're very relieved about that. That is really pretty much everybody's life. It's pretty much everybody's life. Along with maybe some good food and, you know, a few chuckles along the way. It's pretty much everyone's life. We made it through again. We the worst that could happen didn't happen. And that is to, you know, drop this whole unholy trinity of projection, perception, personality, and accept reality as it is. That's the continuity dread. So we're not going to drop it all. We're simply going to replace our boss, our dictator boss, with the Holy Spirit. So we got a new boss. Welcome, new boss. And just see how that feels. That's what I'm trying to do. I keep thinking I've done it, but not yet. But looking at the dynamic of why we're doing it, it has to help us. It has to help us. We're not blind stupid anymore. We're not operating from panic or just blind reaction. We're operating from a very clear, lucid, calm, objective, reasonable clarity, and which is pure pragmatism. It's simply pure pragmatism. making a choice, once we recognize what we're choosing between, then we can make a valid choice, and our will is invested in the choice. So we don't have to heal, we don't have to drop the whole projection issue right off the bat. We put the Holy Spirit, replace our projection of will, dictator, boss, with the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit will lead us into the vision of oneness and say, this is what I want for you. And then we will experience that and abide in that. And then that will remove all remaining concerns that we have about directly knowing reality. So it's pretty basic, pretty simple. It's just a matter of doing it. And boy, we better do it pretty soon. I always say that, and it's always true. It's a truism. Because this world waits for nobody. The dictator of this world, remember, this world is a projection of will. That's what it is. So if you think this world is going to act in a way that you want it to act, you're going to be in for a very rude awakening. It doesn't. It does not. Now, Jesus said we can be happy in the world. Yeah, but only if we put the Holy Spirit in charge of our lives. If we don't, we're not going to be happy. In fact, the world's going to bite us. It's a funny thing, though, that there's some weird effect that if you expect the worst, it doesn't happen, because then that would be your will. It's like your will, this is what you believe is going to happen. Then the boss says, no, I gotta show that I'm a different will than what you are, so I'm gonna do something different. So, you know, if you realize what the boss is trying to do, and you say, okay, boss, I know what you're trying to do, I'm in alignment with that, then the boss will change directions and say, no, I decided not to do that. Because they have to act in a way that's in conflict with your will. That's conflicted with it, and it's different. And saying, I'm superior, I'm telling you to do something different than you want to do. I'm giving you something different than you expected. So it's a strange thing. So that there are ways to kind of change what happens in the world by expecting something and then you'll get something else, actually. But that's a terrible game to play. It's horrible. It's better to replace the dictator with the Holy Spirit. And we know what the Holy Spirit's objective is for us. It's honest. It says a vision of oneness is my objective for you. That's what I'm going to lead you towards. Whereas even if we agree with that and say, okay, that's what I want, the Holy Spirit then won't change directions and say, uh-oh, I need to assert a separate will from you, so I better insist on some other goal. It'll say, great, we share the same goal. We share the same goal. We're not changing. So big difference, big difference. Like you feel like somebody's on your side, finally. Imagine how I'd feel. I don't know how that would feel. I don't know. I really don't know. I've never felt that somebody's on my side, that feeling. And just imagine if you could feel someone's actually really and truly on my side and aligned and not trying to prove it's better than me. So looking forward to that experience for sure. And it's likely to happen soon, because I did ask the Holy Spirit a couple days ago to take charge, and then I had this dream, woke up from the dream where I saw how I'm this conflict I have with this my boss, and how I'm it forces me to do something what I don't want to do. It's funny, because when I tell the boss the things that I most hate and don't want to do, that's what it insists that I do, and that's how I end up. So I say, you know, boss, I just really hope my life doesn't go in this direction and end up in this kind of place. That's the last place I want to end up, so let's make sure we don't do that. What's happened in my life? That's where I ended up. Every time when I say I don't want to do something, the boss insists that I do it. You know, this inner dictator, just to show that it is a separate will from me, and to emphasize this, right? To say, oh, see, your will is you don't want to do this, but my will is being superior. I'm saying you got to do the thing that you hate the most, just to show that how strong my will is. I can get even force you to do what you hate to do the most. That's exactly what I've experienced. And of course, this leads to a very, very bitter life. You hate your life, just, and you don't know why. Why am I, you know, stuck in a situation I can't stand? That's why. Now we know why. It's a way to seem to empower the separate will by forcing you to do the thing you hate the most. And you say, wow, this is really a strong will that can, even though I hate this and I'm trying as hard as possible not to be stuck here, it still is able to force me to be stuck here. Amazing, you know, amazing. Wow, what a powerful will. And then we, deep inside, we're saying, ah, you see, we have a greater will than God. God created my will, but my will's powerless against this other will. Not being honest that, in fact, this other will is just a projection. That is, it is our will. It is our will. So, with this coming to light, like the way it did, I actually had a kind of reaction, sick stomach, my body kind of, it was such a powerful realization. It affected my, how I felt physically a little bit. It was just a, to see that, you know, just directly see it, what was an extremely powerful experience. And one that left me pretty, you know, pretty glum for today, for sure. It's been a very trying day to keep from getting depressed. I felt very, wow. This has been my life, you know. Wow. But better late than never, right? Better that we see it than not see it. Because if we don't see it, we're gonna still be under this spell of this crazy, crazy dictator. And of course, people elect leaders, etc., for similar reasons, to feel that there's some power out there greater than that they are, that is forcing them to do things they don't want to do. And then again, that makes them feel powerless, which is what they really are after. The world is really after feeling powerless, and we keep shifting roles. Right now, we're going in a different direction than the past as far as who plays the powerful role, who plays the powerless role. Right now, it's going towards that men are playing the role of feeling powerless, that they cannot overcome this more powerful force in the world, which is the women of the world are now, you know, in the ascendant as far as power and authority goes. In the past, it was the opposite. The women played the role of that they were powerless against the male. The male was just somehow more powerful than them. Their will was more powerful, and they couldn't escape the clutches of the male will. Now it's the opposite. It's the men who cannot escape the clutches of the female will. But it's the same game that's being played. Is we're projecting some will, greater will, that's in charge over us. That is that we're powerless to escape what it wants for us. You know, even though we want to escape, same game. No different. We haven't gained one iota of insight into this whole thing over the last 50 some odd years, or of all this massive change in the world as far as roles go and authority and will and all this stuff. Not a single iota of real understanding what's going on has taken place. We just wasted our time. And so it's better late than never. It's better that you realize you've just been wasting your time rather than continue to keep wasting it, which is what the world is doing. And it's just the same stupid game. So instead of having some other will, whatever it may be, have the Holy Spirit play that role. The Holy Spirit is not a male, not a female. It's this formless clarity of pure, total purity, immaculate purity, and clarity, and compassion, and pragmatism, and perfect functionality, perfect intelligence, perfect awareness. It cannot be identified with either gender at all. It cannot be identified that way. No. Now, is the vision of oneness, does it have some feel of gender to it? No, none whatsoever. None whatsoever. The feeling that one has, it does not relate to either male or female. It does not. You don't say, oh, this is like great compassion. It's more like a woman because she feels like everyone's her child or something. No, it's not like that. Or it's not like the man saying, this is like I'm able to explore and go to all places, you know, all places I've seen, you know, and through my great activity or something. It's not like that. It doesn't relate to our bodily identity at all. It's this vast, smoothed out richness. Even that doesn't describe it. You can't describe it. For some reason, when I try to describe it, I get this bad reaction. No, that's not the way. Because who are we trying to describe it to? This will, this dictator. We're saying, dictator, I'm going to get free of you because I have this vision of oneness. And the dictator says, oh, really? I don't think so. Okay, I mean, I don't believe you at all. You know, I'm not going to let you go. You say, well, can you describe it to me? I mean, I don't believe you. And I say, well, yeah, it's like this. You kind of feel like this way, that way. And the dictator says, no, I don't think so. I don't think so. I think you're bluffing. I think you're bluffing. That's what this inner dictator says. You're bluffing. Prove it to me. You think, oh man, how do I explain this dictator? As if the dictator will say, oh, I see. You're finally greater than I am. Okay, I'll set you free now. As if it, no, it's not going to say that. It's going to say, you're just bluffing. You're just bluffing. You don't have any such thing at all. You can't even explain it to me. The good news is we don't have to explain it to the Holy Spirit. See, you put the Holy Spirit in charge, we don't have to explain it to the Holy Spirit. We don't have to say, Holy Spirit, I have this vision of oneness, and I feel like I need to explain it to you. And the Holy Spirit says, no, you don't explain anything to me. I know exactly. It is my perception, so I know exactly what it's like. You don't have to explain it at all. And explaining it to other people's dictators is not going to have those dictators relent. They're going to say, no, you're lying, you're bluffing. You can't explain it accurately to me. Well, of course, with words you cannot figure it out or add it up at all. You can say stuff about it, the impressions, etc., but that's not going to change. The dictator's just going to say, well, you're crazy, you're just bluffing, doesn't matter. So this projection of will has to be undone at its root by inviting the Holy Spirit in and say, you take over this role. It doesn't take over your life entirely into just like the same setup now. The dictator's telling you what to do and you feel like you're getting pushed around and bullied, but you still feel like you have your some will and some desire and some idea of what you really want. Well, the Holy Spirit's not going to just completely take over our lives. You know, it will somehow, you know, maneuver us into what is right for us, just like this the dictator does. Somehow the dictator pulls strings and we find ourselves in a terrible situation and we wonder, how in the world did I get here? It's just like crazy, absolutely crazy. Well, the Holy Spirit somehow will maneuver us into the right situation, the optimal situation for us, whereas we still feel as if we're somewhat have some say in that kind of thing. Yeah. So it'll feel similar, it's just that our lives brighten up to an extraordinary extent. And we don't have to be directly aware of how it's done, just like we're not aware of how the dictator manages to put us in such terrible situations. Dangerous situations, all sorts of stuff. You just feel like you're fighting for your life, actually. That's what's happening. The fight for life, just even the fight for survival, all of this comes from this dynamic of projected will and trying to get the sense that there's some will greater than ours, and that to prove this by this will is continually pushing us into situations that we can't stand, even forcing death upon us, you know. Whereas the Holy Spirit is not like that. It's not like that at all. So we may not feel like we're struggling for life at all, that we're fighting some battle for survival. That may all go out the window. We may feel entirely secure. Don't know how any of that stuff feels, really. So it's something to look forward to. So, again, when you feel down, don't give up. Just redouble your efforts. And this is an example of that. I said, you know what? I don't think I can succeed today. Well, trying, still trying, and getting somewhere. I think the shock of realization that I've got this lying, deceiving dictator who will continue to try to force me into situations I don't want. That's a big shock. A very big shock. Because you realize your life is not really your own. And you're under the spell of a maniac. So that, how can that not be shocking? It's very shocking. But I took it in stride, didn't break stride. You know, that's the whole thing about the spiritual path. Don't break stride. This is why we practice every day, taking on the biggest challenge we can every day, and practice not breaking stride. Just taking in stride, okay? You had this recognition, okay? Just keep going. That's how it has to be done. If you think that you can break stride, then you're in trouble. Then you're going to get into depression, etc. Don't break stride. You can slow down, but don't break your stride. You know, you can slow your stride a little bit, but just don't stop. Don't stop and think, uh-oh, I'm defeated. You know, this is it. No, just keep going. Say, I know that something's going to break on this. I know that I'm going to chip away at this. No doubt about it. Even though you don't feel very good, I still don't feel good. It's a very unnerving recognition, very unnerving. Realizing we've been doing all this just to ourselves, and just the unfairness of the boss and the lies and the how it. Explains what it's doing to tells you that you have to do this, just makes up this terrible lies and deceit, and you know, just the worst boss imaginable that would just manipulate you. That's what we have in charge. That's the ego, as some traditions call that. A Course in Miracles calls that the ego. So we switch the ego out for the Holy Spirit, is what we do. But we need clear insight into the term the ego. It's not clear enough. It's way too fuzzy. You have to see what's really going on. It's a projection of our will, right? To try and believe there's a will more powerful than God's will. That's the simple. So just what we've said here in this video, that's a clarification. We don't even have to use the term ego. I don't really like the term ego. That's a psychological term that arose from psychotherapy, and it sort of just was a general way of talking about all the dynamics there are in the troubles of those who just that's the egoic complex, you know. But it's kind of, again, a very fuzzy way of relating to it, and it doesn't really explain anything. It's just that, wow, that's your ego. Okay, what the heck. You know, what the heck is that? What do you mean that's just my ego? So what we've done is we've looked at the actual dynamics themselves. That's what's really going on. There isn't any entity called the ego or something like that. The dynamics, our projection is what's going on. And there is this dictator that we have projected And so that's often referred to as the ego. But again, it ties, for me, it ties me in too much to psychotherapy, the psychotherapeutic language and the fuzziness of it all, which is, which I've studied extensively. And I finally realized it's not good enough. It's not going to free us. It's not going to free us. It doesn't go deep enough at all. Which is partly why A Course in Miracles came into the world. It came into the psychotherapeutic community, actually. His birth was in the manger of the psychotherapeutic community. Columbia University, oh, that's a hot, you know, that whole area, the hotbed of psychotherapy. It came over from Europe to New York and spread throughout the country and the world. And so it came in there, at its birth there. But it basically was saying, you know, we have to get better clarity on what's really going on. I mean, the psychotherapy at least began to look in the right direction. Began to say, wait a minute, I think our problems are coming from within. You know, let's take a look there. Let's see what's going on. Let's just investigate. Let's see what's going on. And then, of course, to deal with clients and where they were at, etc., there had to be some sort of pragmatism they were using. And so they developed various terms and techniques and all this stuff. But insufficient. But at least there was some openness there to, let's look a little closer at this whole situation. Let's see if we can help our clients, our patients, and let's see if we can help them a little better. And so it began in that way, but it's not meant to stay there. I mean, you don't stay in a manger. You know, the child grows up, doesn't stay in the manger. And those who have already kind of investigated the whole psychotherapeutic situation, who are very aware and well informed by the whole thing, and have said, you know what, I want to go farther than this. This isn't far enough. It's not far enough. Then you can take the material and really start to make profound progress, and not just try to fit it into the wineskin of psychotherapy. You know, that's an old wineskin. It's going to burst it. So it really deals with the continuity problem of shallow investigation going into truly in-depth investigation. There's sort of a continuity issue there that we were stuck because these explorers of the psyche, you know, had told us what they had found. They said, this is what is there. And they were such strong authority figures. They were such strong authority figures that we said, wow, that's what I have to find too. And I started finding something different. I said, wait a minute. There's something, supposed to be something wrong with me? How come I'm drawing very different conclusions, seeing something very different than they're seeing? And so being at that crossroads, I was like, wow, I'm in big trouble. Along came A Course in Miracles. And I said, this is what I'm seeing. It's right in this book. This is what I'm seeing. This is what, you know. So I said, this, I'll go with this, because this obviously, whoever wrote this, who's, they're seeing the same thing I'm seeing. They know what's really there. And a lot of people also look towards the East, from Tibetan Buddhist teachers, Zen teachers, Advaita Vedanta teachers, such like that, Sufi teachers, you know, etc. And that helped people say, hey, I'm having these experiences and you know, the Jung's archetypes isn't quite doing it for me. The avant-garde of psychotherapy was very into Jungian archetypes, and we tried to fit everything into those archetypes, like that was the answer. But like now, looking back at it, it's like, you know, hardly scratching the surface, actually. But we thought that was it. Jungian archetypes. And the id and the ego and the superego and all this inner dynamics. We thought they had figured it all out. The Germans, very thorough, you know, they'd figured it all out. No. Basically, they had just, you know, dusted a little bit of dust off the surface, basically, and called it good. You know, just going to a therapist and having someone sympathetic to listen to you gives some relief, because we feel that tyrant, that inner tyrant, that dictator, which is a projected will, you know, is not really our friend. It's our enemy. Like, it treats us like a dog, worse than a dog. It teaches terribly. And here's this therapist who's agreeing with me and saying, yeah, and we say, oh my gosh, how great it is to finally have somebody that is, you know, not treating me that way. So that's the real benefit of the therapy really in the world, as far as going to see a therapist, is just somebody that treats you a little better than the ego, the projected will. You don't feel completely alone, and you know, but it doesn't really cure. It doesn't cure. It's not a cure. It's kind of like taking a, you know, something that can, at least when things are very difficult, it can help. It can help. Therapy can help, but it's not a cure. It's not a cure. And who can afford to go to a therapist 8 hours a day? I mean, the thing is about your own spiritual path, you can do it 16 hours a day, every single day. It doesn't cost a penny. You can do these spiritual exercises I'm sharing with you, and it doesn't cost you anything. And what you feel here is different. You feel like, wow, I feel like I'm taking back my power from something, from somewhere. I feel like I'm regaining something that I threw away, and that's very profound. You feel like, you know what, I feel like I'm going to be actually cured here. But therapy is often a good place to start. My therapist said, I'd never be cured. That's what they still told me. He said, nothing we can do for you. You're incurable. So I said, wow, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Unfortunately, I got a better therapist. Dr. Jesus, Dr. Holy Spirit, Dr. Ramana, Dr. Anandamayi, Dr. Longchenpa, you know, the therapists, really talented therapists who said, you can be cured. We know how you can be cured. You just have to work at it. Really, very industriously work at it. And actually, we're all disturbed here. Everybody's disturbed. And don't waste time pretending that you're not. And don't waste time trying to impress others that you're not disturbed at all. No. No, we're all disturbed. Everyone here is disturbed. Perception itself is profoundly disturbing. The very dynamic that put us here is a dynamic of projection, which is a sense of a loss of will, some greater will controlling our lives. That's extreme disturbance. Perception brings about extreme judgment, which is extreme disturbance. The belief system we have brings about extreme disturbance. So we are all very, very disturbed. Everybody on this planet is very disturbed. So it's better to be honest about it and say, yeah, I'm very disturbed as far as I don't feel that I'm what I'm supposed to be. I don't feel like my life is my own. I got all this pain. I got all this suffering. I don't feel this is right. And you know what? It's not right. It is not right. All pain, all misery, all suffering is not right. It's entirely based coming from projection and this projected will over us. It's coming from there entirely. Our mortality is too. All suffering, all unhappiness is coming from that. Then why do these great gurus die? Because again, continuity issue, they say, this is helpful. If I didn't die, it would be very disturbing for you. It might, you know, so if I let the body die, you're gonna feel more comfortable with the situation. That's why. They don't have to die, actually. Look at Jesus, resurrected. Absolutely. And he said, I don't have to die at all. No way. I'm gonna go through this to point out a certain dynamic. Which, by saying he's the Son of God, what the world want to do? Want to assert that it had a greater will than Jesus? How do they want to prove that? By killing him, killing the body. So that's what he, you know, is pointing out, that our objective purpose for being here is to say that there's a will that's superior to God. How do we prove it? By killing God, right? So Jesus pointed this out to the world, saying, this is what you really are trying to do. You're trying to kill God. And by killing the Son of God, it's the same, because their will is one, you see. The will of God and the Son is one will. But God, the prime creator, is primary. But still one will. So by killing the Son of God, we're saying, look, we have a superior will to God. We can achieve being prime creator. So Jesus, you know, brought that to light and stunned a lot of people, still stunning them. But now he's brought a clearer explanation of what's going on for those who have the ears to hear it. And of course, it's taking us some time to get it, unfortunately. That's the hard one to figure out, but it does. It just does. Got a lot of resistances. One of them is that this desire is still in place, this hold on to our complex here, the projection, perception, and personality, to avoid the continuity dread. We basically pretend that we can't get it to show that we have some kind of superior will, like we have a different will than Jesus. I don't understand what you're talking about. I really can't have a difficult time. That's what we do. And that slows us down. It's really not that difficult, but we make it seem very difficult for us just to show, I'm not going to accept what you have to say. I have a different will. I have a better, stronger will than you. And you cannot force anything upon me, that kind of thing. You can't force truth on me. I'm going to keep believing in lies to prove that you can't force truth upon me. That kind of thing is at play. But it's good to look back in hindsight and see all the mistakes that you made. And then you say, put them to bed, you know, okay. Yeah, let's let go of that one. Wow. At least the crows are quiet right now. Those crows are just an incredible nuisance. Noise polluters. They disturb the peace of the neighborhood severely. Huge flocks of crows just screaming and squawking, and then, you know, wow, raucous, very raucous. It's like a rock band up in the air, some kind of heavy metal band up there. Valkyries or something, or someone just wrathful deities, you know, maybe, you know, wrathful deities up in the air that are maybe one. Now, of course, in this world, we're all saying peace, peace, peace. And I think in the Bible it says, look out when they're all saying peace, peace, peace. That's when the war is going to break out. Why? Like, same dynamic, projected will, forcing something upon us we don't want. When we're all saying, you know what, peace is what we really want. That is what we really want. Everybody wants really peace. Suddenly, the war breaks out, and this, we feel like something horrible has been forced upon us. That's what happens. That's what happens. So we feel that there's some inexorable will that has control of our life that brings us opposite of what we really want. And we feel just so incredibly crushed by it, not recognizing this is actually the expression of our desire to be greater than God. It seems indirect, but it's really very direct. And sometimes when everyone's getting ready to fight, big fight, big fight, suddenly kind of peace breaks out, and it's like, oh, no, no fight. And we kind of say, wow, we're all prepared to this, and this, suddenly something unexpected happened like that. What's in control of our lives? We don't understand it. Same principle. Still unconscious. We're unconscious of what's going on. In a coma. We're like, we're in a coma. A coma of projection. A coma of submission to some superior will. Other, that's not God. I'm still waiting for my driver. I won one on eBay. It's an older model, 2011 model, and it's got 8.5 degrees of loft, which is very minimal loft, extremely difficult to hit. Even the pros don't hit 8.5 very much anymore, so it's pretty interesting. We'll see if I can even hit it at all, but I think I will be able to. A new driver, not hitting, popping it up so high and losing distance, but rather extending it out there, you know, for a long distance. We'll see what happens. Very interesting. I thought no way in the world could I hit 8.5, and I ended up ordering one. It just popped up there. Just the whole thing, just amazing how it happened. I said, okay, I'll see if I can hit it. And you know, it sort of is a corollary to what we're talking about here, of putting the Holy Spirit in charge of our life. We think, wow, that's just too difficult. You know, I don't know if I'll be able to do it. And I'm saying, I got this new driver, and I don't know if I'll 8.5. I don't know if I'll be able to hit that. I mean, how can I hit that? I don't know. How can we put the Holy Spirit in charge of our life? But if I do hit it, you know, it's probably going to be just, you know, tremendous distance. Being able to launch what I'm launching right now very high. 8.5 is going to give it a less of a really high launch, but still high enough, I believe. And so it's going to carry much further and roll out much further. And most people say, no, whatever you do, don't get this club. Whatever you do, you're not going to be able to hit it. So I don't know what's going to happen. And most people say, whatever you do, don't put the Holy Spirit in charge of your life. It's going to be too demanding, too difficult. You're aiming too, you know. Your aim is too strong. Get something easier. Just try to appease this dictator, you know, instead of put the Holy Spirit in charge. I say, no, I'm going to put the Holy Spirit in charge and see what happens. So, due, I guess, late Wednesday. The package tracking says late Wednesday, so I got to wait still quite some time for it. Take a long, long time. Wow. So we think that putting the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's going to just like be too difficult for us. We won't be able to handle it. Won't be able to handle it at all. No way. But I'm thinking, you know what? What exactly is it going to do that's so difficult? I've already seen the vision of oneness and glimpsed it, and I said, wow, that's exactly what I want. That's great. Love it. So nothing to fear there. So what exactly, you know, is the Holy Spirit going to do that's so terrible? That's the question. I don't think we have a good answer for that. Maybe we need to look into that. What is it so terrible that's going to happen? Well, I guess we're thinking that it's going to set us up in such a great way, and then somehow it's going to then leave us, and then the other dictator come back and say, oh my gosh, I'm really going to punish you severely. I'm going to change your circumstances totally because that's not what I want. You know, so in other words, we're afraid to get what we want, thinking that then this dictator is going to then severely change things on us to show that he has a superior will. I don't know, it's a very interesting question. I'm sure if any golfer would hear the club I'm getting, they'd say, you're crazy. You can't hit that thing. I'm actually using a very unique, different stance right now to save my back. So the combination of this very unique stance and a club that is extremely difficult to hit, we'll see what happens. I believe it's going to be fine, actually. I think it's going to be great. But all the golf teachers, instructors, players, they'd say, you're nuts. And that stance will never work, and that club will never work. And, you know, what are you doing? You're just not following the book, the advice. We'll see. We'll see. We'll see what happens. That's for sure. And for some reason, I have enough understanding of my swing and everything to feel like I'm going to be able to pull this off. Same thing with the Holy Spirit. I feel I have enough understanding to be able to put the Holy Spirit in charge of my life and have that to be a positive, the right experience that I want. It's not going to slice off into oblivion. You know, they say this club is going to slice. You're just going to slice it completely out of bounds. There's no way you're going to hit this thing properly. It's too difficult to control. But you just put a swing on it that keeps the club face closed. And then they say, no way will it go left, so you'll probably be able to keep it straight, actually. And most people say, you know, the Holy Spirit's in charge of your life. You're going to go off the rails. You're going to be sliced away into oblivion. You know, just, you're a goner. You're a goner. Lost ball. Lost ball. Out of bounds. Ball's going to be out of bounds. You know, but I don't think so. I don't, that's not how I look at it. I think it's going to go right down the middle beautifully. You know, just tremendous, tremendous drive. Because what else is there to do except to share right spiritual teaching with people? Already done that. You know, just and let them know that it's fine. Everything's fine. So I'm going to go for it, and we'll see what happens. We will see what happens. Okay. Very great. Getting ready to transition to the end of this video. And time is 9:30. I'll keep trying more stuff tonight until midnight or so, for sure. Now is the time to make your effort, to redouble your efforts. Now is the time. Now is the time. The world is this Frankenstein monster, actually, and it's very unpredictable what it's going to do. But for sure, it's going to assert its will over you, this world, for sure. That's its whole purpose. So that's not fun for anybody. So we want to put the Holy Spirit in charge of our lives, okay? So that's what I'm going to do, and that's what I recommend for others to investigate this possibility. Before you do it, investigate it. Look at it. Say, is this what I really want to do? Maybe I do. Investigate it. Don't take my word for it. Investigate it for yourself. And see and look at the underlying dynamics like we're doing here and say, hey, maybe that's a good idea, you know. Keep investigating it. All right, that's it.